What's up, everybody? Welcome back to 55 Minute Physiology. In today's episode, we're finally gonna do it. We're taking the plunge, folks, and we're gonna talk about calories. I can't go a single day without seeing something on social media about people arguing back and forth about how calories are the only thing that matter or that they don't matter at all. And really, to be honest, I'd say it frustrates me, but it doesn't, because I don't even care. It's so bad. People have such a fundamental lack of understanding of what's really going on. I finally decided, let's make a video. We will walk people through the very basics of calories, what they really are, what matters, particularly in respect to energy balance. So where this conversation comes most into play is, in other words, do I need to cut calories to lose weight? Yes or no? Are there some other mechanisms, or gain muscle for that matter? And I think what you're going to find here is, even though we're covering the basics, the vast majority of people, and this includes PhDs, nutritionists, experts in the field, don't understand the very, very fundamental concepts that I'm about to lay out to you today. It's honestly not that complicated. It blows my mind how people don't understand these basics. It really shocks me. All right, so we're going to have some interesting conversations, and I think if we do this and we spread this message and this basic information gets out, then I think we can have some very interesting and very important conversations about food, because it does extend far beyond just calories. But we can't get there unless we can have some basic agreement about what's going on with calories, with quality, with quantity. And we can throw away the zealots and the people on the extremes. So let's tackle it. Let's jump right in. Energy balance, quality versus quantity, the great calorie debate. Well, what you first have to recognize is, whenever someone puts you in this position or asks you the question of, well, what's more important, calories or quantity or quality? The first thing I want you to understand is, this is by definition a false dilemma. Right, this is what we call in logic a fallacy of black and white. There is no such thing. It's not one or the other. I'm not sure why people think that it has to be quality or it has to be quantity. It's obviously both. Whether we're talking about eating for performance, muscle gain, fat loss, health, longevity, it's a combination of both. Clearly, you can't have high quality food and totally mismatch calories. I'm not going to name names here, but there are some people that get a lot of attention who will purport the idea that literally calories don't matter. And I've heard people on very prominent podcasts get cornered with this, and the host will graciously give them an out to say things like, well, surely if you ate 15,000 calories a day of this food that you say is magical, you would gain weight. And then proponents say, no, you still wouldn't. I'm telling you, you wouldn't. And that's utterly ridiculous. There is some point where calories matter. The flip side of the equation, just because you count all your calories and line them up and you eat crap food all day, you're not going to be in good health, performance, recovery, standing. So the obvious answer here is, let's just stop the conversation about what's more important and realize that both of them have a very significant role. So that's our first step in understanding what's going on with this calorie debate. And I can give you a couple of very practical examples. This is my friend Tori, and she asked me to come to one of her gyms that she was working out with a couple of years ago. And one of her friends was in the audience, and they were asking me about calories. And her friend had lost, bless her heart, 50 or 60 pounds or something over the year or two before. And I said, great, what was your approach? And she said, I didn't pay attention to anything except eating the highest quality foods I could. And I said, fantastic. That's amazing. That's a win for everybody, right? And so then I said, well, what's your question then? Sounds like you're doing great. And she said, well, really, I've been stalled for 2 or 3 months. And I haven't lost any weight in that amount of time. And so my response was, well, have you started eating less food? And she looked at me like with complete bewilderment. Well, what do you mean? Quality is the only thing that matters. And then it hit her like a light bulb. Oh, shit. Of course, quantity matters at some point, right? So in her particular case, maybe it was best for her to start by just focusing only on quality. But at some point, folks, quantity does start to matter. And we can have a good conversation later in a separate point about what's better to start, people focusing quantity or quality. But we do have to recognize both matter. In her particular case, all the best quality in the food, it's not going to have you get to a negative caloric balance, which is what you have to have, as we'll see in a second, to lose weight eventually. you're going to have to bring those calories down. And the opposite of that equation there is, this is my friend Lauren. And she came out and worked in my lab for the summer, and she's actually here right now, and she told me a wonderful story of herself. And she said I could use this. And by that I mean I didn't ask her at all, and I'm just totally throwing her out there. She doesn't really have social media, but if you see her, find her, when you make sure that you make fun of her and let her know that I brought her up in my video. But Lauren told me that, you know, she went through the same problem where she ate a whole bunch of calories and she thought quality is the only thing that mattered, and so she thought she could eat in excess. Just any food didn't matter as long as it was high quality food, it was, you know, fresh vegetables and food and non-processed food, and she gained a ton of weight. And so what she had to also realize is, yeah, you know what, you can live for the most part getting away with it if you're focusing on quality foods relative to less quality foods. You have a bigger buffer, but that buffer is not limitless. It does start to matter at some point. So make sure you're being cognizant that calories do count. And so I love this physics joke. You probably won't care for it, and you can pause the screen. I'm not gonna go the whole thing in detail, but it basically says something like this, that the traditional view of weight loss says that there's a certain amount of calories in, certain amount of energy expenditure out, and if you have more calories in than out, there's a net energy gain. In opposition to that, if you have less calories in and or more calories going out, then you have a net energy loss. But then for some reason, we think that there's this revolutionary new diet where you can have more calories in, no calories out, and that somehow the calories will vanish in this anomaly of space-time continuum or something like that. So I don't know how that exactly works to people. You're gonna hear the argument of an open versus a closed system. I get all that, but you're really missing the boat. And to be honest with you, it doesn't matter. Hopefully what I'm gonna lay out to you in the next few minutes is this is not the right conversation. It's utterly unimportant. We're having a physics conversation about something that is really very clear. Calories do matter. They are not the only part of the equation, but they do matter. Right? So who cares about this? It's really not that important. What I'm really getting at here is this point. Whether someone comes to you or you go to your client with a quality is most important approach, or you go with a quantity is most important approach, either one of those are just a system to help you get to the same place, which is what we call a desired energy balance. And this is what it's really most about for this context. Again, this is where somebody who's trying to gain muscle or lose fat, you've got to get them in the proper energy balance. So you can use a combination of emphasizing quality or emphasizing quantity, whatever you want. They're both just different systems aimed at getting you to the same thing. Now, most people can see this from the quantitative perspective, right? Obviously, if I'm focusing on quantity, that's getting me directly to energy balance. But the real loss of conversation or the confusion here happens with the qualitative. How is it that emphasizing quality only works if it's all about balance? We hear this all the time, right? Well, I didn't figure it all. I didn't count calories. I went up in maybe calories, and maybe you could document that. You went way up in calories, but yet you lost weight. If calories are the only thing that counted, how is that physically possible? And they think that's proof that they're right. Well, what people don't realize is the next 15 or 20 minutes here, I'll show you how if you emphasize quality, oftentimes that leads you into a proper energy balance. So in either case, it still is about energy balance. It's just different ways to get there. So let's talk for quite a few minutes here about how calorie counting works. Now, in general, it doesn't work very well for a bunch of different reasons. And the first one is adherence, right? Now, keep in mind, see how the word there, general, is underlined? I'm not saying it doesn't work, because I'm gonna get 1,000 comments from people that says, I counted calories and I lost 100 pounds, or I've kept it. Fine, there are actually a huge amount of people in this on this planet that are just fine counting calories. In fact, point number one is adherence. So counting calories can be effective, but the reason it generally doesn't work is it's very hard to do. You've got to track and weigh and measure things, and you've got to be very judicious about that. That works for some people. In fact, if you want to listen to my podcast, The Body of Knowledge, that's up on Stitcher and iTunes, thebodyofknowledge.com, go to season one, chapter 1.6. I talk in there about how I like to categorize people as different personality types. I also talked about this on the Joe Rogan podcast when I was on there. And I actually label people as cooks, bakers and chefs. And you can watch those episodes of that podcast to hear more about that. But some people do very well with a detailed plan that includes tracking, weighing, measuring. If that's one of you, fantastic. I would encourage you to try calorie counting and tracking. It can work fine. It's millions of people have lost millions of pounds doing it. Having said that, a lot of other people don't do very well on it. And so one of the major reasons why people would then think, hey, calories don't matter, is because I tried a calorie counting diet and it failed. Right? But that's not actually meaning the diet, the physics and the chemistry is not true. It just means it didn't work for the adherence, which is a very legitimate conversation. It's just not, doesn't mean the calories don't count. So the second one is accuracy, and the third one is that some calories have an influence on behavior. And so let's talk a little bit more about those next two, starting with the accuracy. So the first reason why calorie counting, well, again, this is whether you're trying to go up and you're like, I'm having a hard time gaining muscle, I've increased calories, or you're trying to use it to lose fat. It's really the same conversation. It's about manipulating calories. Right, so how do you know how many calories to consume? The only way to really do that is to go through some type of assessment. And there's a bunch of different ways you can do that. But in order to get there, you have to understand one fundamental concept, is the total amount of energy that you use, in other words, the total energy expenditure, TEE, is a combination of three things, really. Three major categories. Number one, your resting metabolic rate. You may have also heard this referred to as basal metabolic rate. Now, those are not the same exact thing, but for our purposes here, they're close enough. So it's your resting metabolic rate plus what's called your exercise activity thermogenesis. In other words, how many calories you burn through exercise. And the last category is your non-EAT, so your non-exercise activity thermogenesis. Now, if you add up resting metabolic rate, eat, and NEAT, that's going to tell me how many calories you're burning. So how many calories you're burning to just be alive, resting metabolic rate. This is to run your immune system, to pump your blood, to grow hair, all the things your body has to do to minimally survive. Plus how many calories you burn from working out and how many calories you burn from non-exercising physical activity. You add all that stuff up and you understand how many calories you get. Well, in order to then know resting metabolic rate, eat and NEAT, you have to have some sort of assessment. And you have a bunch of different options here. I'll start actually at the bottom with number four. I think honestly the best metric, the best way to assess here, especially for fat loss, is test-retest. In other words, are you tracking and weighing your body composition? If you're doing that, who cares about what your calorie prescription's at? Right, so what I honestly do most of the time is, okay, track and weigh your weight. Let's make sure we're not losing all muscle mass if it's weight loss. And over the course of several months, are you having an adequate balance of, are you not too hungry all the time? We don't want you to be hungry, very often at all. Are you losing weight? Are you still feeling recovered? Are you sacrificing sleep quality? Anything like that? Because if you are like, hey, I'm satiated, I feel fine, I'm not feeling like I'm restricted, I'm losing weight at the appropriate rate, I'm feeling recovered, not having any other problems, then that's a perfect caloric assessment. If you're all those things are going well, but you're not losing weight, then we maybe have to lower calories. Or if you're losing a ton of weight, but it's coming at the cost of recovery or sleep or motivation or something like that, then maybe we need to bump calories back up. All right, but the other approach, moving sort of up the ladder, which I think is equally unfeasible, is some sort of a laboratory assessment. And we'll talk about that sort of quickly. What most people do actually is number three, which is get some sort of estimate. So you can look anywhere online or textbooks or studies and you can get things that say, hey, here, based on your age, height, weight, here's how you would estimate your BMR or your RMR. And here's how you could estimate your physical activity. You could see that, of course, on something like a treadmill or an elliptical that'll tell you, hey, here's your estimated calories you're burning. Recognize, folks, those are tremendously inaccurate. And if you know anything about me, you know my stance on the actual trackers, the apps on your phone, things like that are horrendously bad with accuracy. But these are all your different approaches. So going back to the laboratory one, this is what you would actually have to do to honestly know how your total energy expenditure. So you can see in the picture over here with the lady laying down, she's actually getting her basal metabolic or resting metabolic rate assessed. So you have to lay in a laboratory with a big hood over your face and have all of the calories you're burning, inhaling and exhaling, measured for a couple of hours. And this would give you a pretty good indication of your basal metabolic rate. You would also then have to be like the gentleman on the right and wear that thing portably, and those units cost about $30,000 each. You have to wear that when you're doing your physical activity and your exercise. And you'd have to wear that all day. That's the only real way to know exactly how many calories you're burning. And so it's pretty impractical and unfeasible for most people. And this is why they generated these prediction equations that are, they're okay for a big, you know, 350 million people at a time, but for the individual person, it's pretty inaccurate. Other things you can do in terms of assessment are things like diet recalls. So it could be a 24-hour, 48-hour recall. So in other words, you look back and you go, say, okay, how much did I eat yesterday, today, and you kind of list everything due. And then you upload that to some website that'll give you a breakdown of how many calories you consumed or your physical activity, things like that. And there's some benefit here, just like anything else, but there's also some potential problems. Number one is honesty. People aren't necessarily always forthright with exactly what they ate and how much. Memory is a problem, of course. Sometimes you don't remember exactly what you ate in the last 48 hours. Knowledge is a big difficulty, especially with people who are not in this field, of portion size. So people don't know what 3 ounces really looked like. They don't know what a pound was, or 6 milliliters. They really guess. And if they're off by more than 5 or 10%, then everything's out of whack anyways, because that's how much you're trying to adjust calories for the most part as you go. There are several studies now that have shown that people that are obese tend to underestimate their portion sizes by about 50% when they report. And this is the population we're probably most trying to help, and they're the ones that are the most inaccurate with their portion knowledge for the most part. There are also other considerations. What happens if you did a diet recall on a very atypical day? It's going to throw all your numbers and your equations off. We also have some evidence to suggest that people who have a lower education also have a more inaccurate or worse response. And so you can use a recall, but there's all kinds of problem there. I actually encourage people to use this. This is the NIH. Kevin Hall, I think, put this together. And it's a website that you can use, and it's free, where you can track a lot of your metrics. Now, anyone that's ever done any tracking before, you're probably rolling your eyes right now. I understand. Because I feel like for 10 or 15 years, there were online trackers for caloric estimations, and they were just terrible. And they didn't evolve at all. This one is completely different. I promise you, you can go to the Body Weight Planner, Google NIH Body Weight Planner. It is way different than anything that's ever been out there. And I think it's actually extremely good. It allows you to have a lot of manipulation of different things, really personalized, individualized. And it is by far the most accurate thing I've seen, the most usable thing, especially for individualization. So I'm showing you the front screen right here. And you're probably looking at it again being like, wow, I've seen this 1,000 times. But I'm telling you, a lot more goes into it than just this front screen. I just didn't want to show you all of it. So you can use an app like that or 1,000 different apps if you prefer one over the other. It's really up to you, but this is really how you would track it. So the obvious question then, and I've sort of alluded to some of these answers a couple of times, of which of these things are the best? And if you've ever had a class from me or seen many of these videos, you know the answer is, it depends. You're gonna have to understand the context of the situation. So if you're working with somebody, I think it's very rare that you really need to go to step number one here. Getting in a laboratory and have a 24-hour assessment is probably very unlikely to be needed. You might be able to get away with a 3-day food tracker. Upload it to Kevin Hall's system there, and that might be good enough. Maybe you want to go more extensive, or maybe even an estimate's good enough. All right. This is up for you to decide, depending on the context, the situation, how important knowing calories really are for your situation. So that's what you would really do to assess it. You also have to keep in mind this factor, and this is what makes things even more difficult. So at the top, you can see that equation again. So TEE, which is your total energy expenditure, equals that resting metabolic rate, eat and eat. But keep in mind a couple of things. You have the thermal effect of food, which is that TEF, is a function or a part of that resting metabolic rate. And as we'll see in a second here, that changes depending on what you eat. Therefore, your resting metabolic rate changes quite often, by the hour actually, depending on when you're eating. Now, your resting metabolic rate generally accounts for about 50 to 60% of your TEE. And it is pretty variable there, and it depends, but it's a big chunk of your total energy expenditure. Your EAT, in other words, your exercise calories, has a tremendous variability well, because a lot of people are kind of exercise, some people exercise really, really hard, so it can be 10 to 30% of your total caloric expenditure as well. But the real big one is NEAT, and this is the one that really has changed our view of how calories work in the last 20 years or so. Once we started to realize that your NEAT, which is your physical activity, is what I call it, right? So exercise is exercise, but things like walking, gardening, doing the dishes, having sex with your partner, all that is not really exercise. It's more like physical activity, but it can count for a significant amount of weight management. Fidgeting also, so those of you that like tap your feet or you're always kind of moving around, that burns actually a significant amount of calories throughout the day. Standing versus walking, so those of you that have heard things like, well, how can standing help, you know, having a standing desk help me lose weight? It'll actually add a couple of calories per hour. That builds out throughout a day, throughout a week, throughout a month, throughout a year. That adds to be several pounds. And so the note I put at the bottom there, the NEAT can actually add up to or remove an additional 100 or 150 extra kcals per hour for some people. And the reason I have it highlighted is because the vast majority of the research is going in the direction of saying NEAT is the real thing that causes somebody to have a hard time gaining weight or have a hard time losing weight. This seems to be the really big variable. It's also something you have a tremendous ability to play with. You can influence it heavily by doing things like just being more active, walking more, standing desks or fidget desks or things like that. As I mentioned here though, this has really high personal intra and interperson variability, and a lot of different things influence this. It's not the same every single day. A lot of these numbers change with your mood, your environment, your sleep, what the temperature is outside. You can induce some shivering if you're a little bit cold. And this is some of the research that has showed setting the thermostat in your house down a few degrees can actually lead to substantial fat loss over the course of a couple of months, just being a little bit colder, because it influences NEAT, has it go up just a few percentage points. As you start losing weight, you also have to realize you have to adjust caloric prescription because you have a bunch of different things that happen. Number one, the thermal effect of food goes down as you start losing weight because you stop eating as much, right? So the thermal effect of food is the energy that you burn breaking down food in your stomach. Well, if you're eating less food, you're going through less thermal effect of food. You're going through less TEF, resting metabolic rate is then coming down. NEAT also goes down, potentially to conserve. And so this is what I'll talk about in a few slides from now. But you sort of have something that you're fighting here. As you lower the calories you eat, there is some theory here that your body will match that by lowering its NEAT to keep you conserved at a body weight. And this is why if somebody who's ever really crashed down on calories and then it didn't work and you went down harder in calories, and it didn't work and you went down harder in calories, and you're like, I'm not losing any weight, therefore calories don't matter. No, they totally matter. Your body's just compensating for your lack of ingesting calories by reducing its caloric expenditure. And you're like, no, I kept my exercise the same. Well, you might have, but your body might have just throttled way down on the NEAT, which is really happens very often. And I'll tell you a story about that happening to one of my athletes here in a second. The third thing you have to consider is resting metabolic rate goes down just from a fact of being smaller. And this is really dependent on what you're actually losing. So if you're losing fat, your resting metabolic rate won't go down that much. If you're losing muscle, it'll go down a little bit more. Now, it's not a huge number, but it is a number, and that does start to matter. Fourth, EAT goes down, right? So smaller people burn less calories for exercise. So as you're now a smaller person, that same exact exercise bout doesn't burn as many calories. And then lastly, you really have to consider what you're losing. So you've lost some weight now, but where did that weight come from? Fat, water, calories, all those play a factor as well. So that's something you have to consider, that even though maybe you started off on a diet where you're measuring calories and it was working, all of a sudden it's not working anymore. Well, you have to realize these factors are playing into the conversation and the calculation as well. So here's an example of what I was talking about just a second ago. Now, this paper made waves a couple of years ago, and before I talk about it, I want to make sure we add some caveats here. This is not widely accepted by the scientific community yet. In fact, there's a lot of questioning what's going on here. It's really more of a concept than it is extremely known. And what Ponser, the author's point here was, is there's potentially an evolutionary advantage to actually countering a caloric deficit with a caloric restriction of NEAT. So in other words, if you reduce your calorie intake by 300 calories, your body might reduce its NEAT by 300 calories to make sure your total energy expenditure is the same. Or the same with exercise. If you burn an extra 300 calories with exercise, your body might match it by reducing NEAT by 300 to keep you at the same total energy expenditure. And I mean, from an evolutionary perspective, in theory at least, this would keep you alive. So this is a fun experiment, and as I mentioned, it's not widely accepted or anything, but it does highlight the fact that this can happen sometimes when you reduce calories, especially if you reduce them too low for too far. I think I spoke about this on Joe Rogan's podcast. I was fortunate enough to work with Olympic gold medalist and three-time defending world champion now Helen Maroulis. And this is what happened to her prior to making way for the Rio Olympics, is really restricted for a long time, kept lowering calories, and body weight just wasn't changing. We eventually went way up in calories, and all of a sudden body weight just started falling off. Now that was not proof that calories don't matter. It was proof that something like this happens and that your intake and your extake, or your expenditure, are not just stale factors. They're mosaic, and they're influenced by a lot of different things. Another concept similar to that is another commentary. Now, this is not original data. This is a commentary about debunking the myth that exercise is an effective weight loss treatment. Now, keep in mind here, they are not saying you don't need to exercise for weight loss. What they're simply talking about is the calorie portion of it. In other words, don't think you're going to lose weight because you're burning more calories from exercise. You're gonna lose that equation, and I'll explain that in a second. Now there's 1,000,000,000,000,000,000 reasons why you need to exercise for your health, longevity, your physical performance, and a million other reasons. And absolutely, exercise is a critical portion of any weight loss and obviously of any muscle gain diet. What they're simply saying here is it's not a very good way to manipulate calories for the sake of weight loss. That's the argument, and that is pretty well established. They're actually right there. And so I'll give you some examples here. You can see the foods on the left and how many calories that are actually in them. Well, people are extremely distorted in their understanding or view of how many calories they burn with exercise. And that is a lot of the times because you're being marketed to like that. So a company that wants to sell their gym or their group exercise class is going to tell you things like, hey, our class burns 1,000 calories a day. You burn 1,000 calories in this workout. Well, that's extremely unlikely. You're more likely going to burn 200 or 300 calories in an hour-long exercise bout. And so you can see in the slide here some of the equations. So, you know, you had that extra Cinnabon, that might take you an hour of aerobics class to burn off, right? You had that extra large fry, you might have to hop on the rower for an hour and a half. So it's completely unreasonable to think that you can out-exercise eating too many calories. Again, exercise is critical for some other reasons we don't have time to get into, but it's not going to be the thing that leads you to that energy deficit you're looking for. Especially if, you know, you're a college kid or otherwise, and maybe on a random Friday night you go out for a couple of Cokes, and, you know, not like you would add anything to that Coke, like rum or vodka or anything, right? Making the calories go up any higher. And since you're a responsible young adult, you only have 2 or 3, right? You wouldn't have 10 or 12. And then since you're responsible and you didn't have 10 or 12, you wouldn't go home and then add a whole thing of Easy Mac dinner, have some extra fries and nachos on top of that, right? No, of course you wouldn't do that. And you wouldn't do that every single Friday and most Saturday nights, right? So you wonder why it's hard to lose weight. The calories add up really, really, really fast. You couldn't have a night like that and then think, oh man, I had a terrible night last night. Oh, don't worry though, I'm gonna go train really hard tomorrow. You'll never catch up to that 2,000 calories. Not even close. So it's just a lot better to not eat the junk in the first place for the sake of managing calories for energy deficit or surplus. The other thing also is, this should help you understand that you should not eat for reward. So do not fall into the trap of saying like, oh, I had a great workout, I burned 800 calories, therefore I'm gonna go reward myself with pizza tonight. You're gonna crush past 800 calories or 200 calories or whatever it is really, really, really fast. Another thing to keep in mind, let's say you did burn 800 calories in a hard workout. That doesn't mean you're at an 800 calorie deficit. Because remember, if it took you an hour to burn 800 calories in a hard workout, you wouldn't have burned 0 calories in that hour sitting on the couch. You still have basal metabolic rate, right? You're burning some calories. Maybe it's 50 calories sitting on the couch, maybe it's 100. I don't know, it's something, right? So really, what you have to do is take however many calories you burn from your exercise, minus that by how many you would have burned in that same time sitting there. That's your deficit. So in this case, maybe it's not 800 calorie deficit, maybe it's 600 calorie deficit. This stuff starts to matter over time if you're miscalibrating by a couple of hundred calories, right? Okay, so that covers for the most part the accuracy stuff. As I mentioned, this is one of the reasons why calorie counting in this case maybe isn't the best, because so many factors go into it, it ends up being a wild guess, right? It's really off depending on the person and all the other factors. One thing I haven't touched on yet is food labeling. What you don't realize, food labels can be off by 10, maybe a little 15%. So this is really problematic. If you think you're having a 500 calorie meal and it's actually 550 calories or 450 calories or less. And so it's really difficult because we're not very standardized in that, and some companies are even worse than that 10 or 15% marker. We've talked about user error a lot. People have a really hard time understanding and tracking what's actually they're really consuming, especially if they're not using a scale. But I think the one that surprises people the most, and this is probably the part of the video where you're gonna go, oh my God, I can't believe nobody explained this to me ever before. All of these things you've heard and all these arguments are going to make a lot more sense when you hear these next two final points. In fact, I don't understand why this is not the beginning of the conversation every time this topic comes up, because it seems like people who argue that calories don't matter at all don't have the faintest clue of these last two points. And that blows me away how you could have a PhD or write books in this field and not understand the next two points. So here's the argument, right? So people say, all right, well, if all calories are equal and all that matters is energy balance, how is it, are you really gonna try to say that, for example, a half a cup of Crisco, which would be 1,000 calories, is equal to 1,000 calories, which would be 20 cups of carrots? No, of course not. And then they would say, aha, that's proof. Calories don't count, don't matter. No, that's proof you don't understand basic physiology and basic chemistry. That's not at all how it works. Obviously, 1,000 calories of carrots is far better for you for weight management stuff than half a cup of highly processed, crappy calories in Crisco, right? So what's the difference here? Well, it comes down to a couple of things. Number one, caloric absorption. Now, caloric absorption is not really the right idea or the right word. Really what it comes down to is composition and thermal effect of food. And then satiety, or satiety, the sensation of feeling full. So here's really what happens. Now you have to realize that a portion of the calories you ingest can be lost into non-digestible fiber. So if you want, you can go back and watch some of the other videos when I've explained to you what carbohydrates really are. And so a portion of carbohydrates are fiber. That's right, fiber is a carbohydrate. So if you had 1,000 calories of carrots, you would acknowledge there's a lot of fiber in carrots or in fruits and vegetables. Not a lot of fiber in Crisco. So of those 1,000 calories, let's say, and I'm making these numbers up, it doesn't matter at all. The scale really doesn't matter if I'm way off. It's going to highlight the same point. So of those 1,000, say there were 50 grams of fiber, and you know that there's 4 calories per gram of carbohydrate. So of those 1,000, 200 are actually fiber. Now, some fiber you can digest and you'll absorb just fine. Some of it you can't, and it actually just goes through your system. And this is why fiber helps us defecate, right? So I'll just call it 50-50. So half of those fiber are digestible, half are not. Again, that's not really a realistic number, but you get the idea. So what that really means is, since there's 200 calories of that 1,000 or fiber, and of that 200, 100 of them you can't actually break down in your gut. You can if you're a cow, but you can as a human. And so that goes out. So really, of those 1,000, you actually only absorb 900. Aha. And this is what I was referring to earlier when I said the calories in your food or on your label are not the same as calories in your belly. It's because of the composition of food. Now, the fat, on the other hand, there's not much fiber in there, basically zero. And so of those 1,000, you're going to absorb 1,000. This is how eating high-quality foods, particularly foods that are high in fiber, or just foods that are really complex and hard, like carrots, right? You're not going to be able to extract everything out of the carrot. Corn, you see this all the time, right? And so even though 1,000 calories are coming in, quote unquote, you would be in a hypocaloric state with the carrots because you're not actually getting all 1,000 out of that. You have other issues with digestion, but basically fat is very simple and doesn't require very much energy to digest and store, where items like a carrot, and the thing here is the physical structure. It's physically dense. It takes a long time. Protein, meat, non-predigested things are much more difficult and take more energy to break down because of their various composition. So here's the analogy of the example I would give you. Since I really appreciate all the support you give me on my Patreon account and for watching these videos, what I'm going to do is anybody that shares this video and tags me in it in their social media or on their YouTube, I'm going to give $1,000 to you. And I will pay you by sending you 10 $100 bills. It's going to look just like that. Beautiful, crisp Franklins. Good Benny Franks, right? Well, actually, half of you I'm going to do that too. So half of you get 1,000, you get 10 $100 bills. The other half of you get $1,000 as well. Don't worry. I'm going to take care of you all. Daddy's got you. Don't worry. But in this case, you're going to get 5 $100 American bills. And you're going to get 5 $100 Monopoly bills. It's 1,000 either way, right? Well, yes, kind of, but half of this one isn't usable. And so it's not that the money doesn't matter. It's you do have to factor in how much you can actually use. And so instead of being all happy like the baby here, you probably now just went like that. Right? This is really fiber in this case. The Monopoly money would be the fiber. All right, so you have to factor that stuff in as well when you're trying to understand energy balance. The other big thing is called the thermal effect of food. Now, this has been abbreviated as TEF throughout the entire presentation so far. And what I've actually done is I've added protein as well. All right, and this is what about 1,000 calories would be 18 ounces of steak. And I know that there's fat in there too. And I'm just trying to show you the macronutrients, right? Fat, protein, carbohydrate. All equated for total calories. Here's what we understand. It takes a tremendous amount of energy in your belly, in your body, to break down fat. In fact, it takes about 20 to 30% of the calories in the food item to break it down. So if you ingested 1,000 calories of protein, you would burn 200 to 300 calories just digesting it. It's a very, very high thermal effect. Now, fat, it's not very high at all. It's basically zero, a couple percent. Carbohydrate, it can be high, can be low. Look, you're not going to have a very high thermal effect of breaking down a piece of bread. But for something more complex like broccoli or carrots or things like that, you're going to burn a significant amount of those calories just breaking it down. It's got a decently high thermal effect. So this, again, further explains why 1,000 calories of high-quality food is going to probably lead to more fat loss than 1,000 calories of low quality food, right? But calories still matter, right? It's helping you get into a negative caloric balance. And I really like this post by Menno. Hendelsman. You can check out his social media, Bayesian Bodybuilding. It's great stuff. I want to give him a shout out because it's a very, very good post he had up a while ago. And what he did is he highlighted his paper. You can see the study in the bottom corner if you want to read more about it. But what the study did is they put two groups of people on the exact same calorie diet, or the exact same calorie meal, 730 calories. One of them was a highly processed, low-quality food. The other one was a whole food, a higher quality. Well, what happened was the low-quality food had a thermal effect of about 10%. So they burned about 73 calories digesting and breaking down that 730 calories. The other group had a thermal effect twice that, 20%. And so this is, again, highlighting that point that oftentimes, I'll grant you, just emphasizing quality will take care of quantity, but that doesn't mean quantity doesn't matter. Just like I talked about at the very beginning with that friend at the CrossFit gym that I helped out or had a conversation with. Maybe you do only need to emphasize quality, but you still do need to recognize quantity matters. But maybe quality helps you get to a better quantity. Right? That's all it's doing. Right? The last one here is satiety. This is your sensation of full. Well, it turns out protein is by far the most satiating macronutrient. And this is one of the many reasons why if people are particularly concerned with losing fat, it's very advantageous to increase protein. Now that sounds kind of counterintuitive, right? But that's right. If you want to lose fat, go up in protein. It has that higher thermal effect and it makes you feel full. You should not be feeling hungry all the time when you're trying to lose weight. You're doing it wrong. If you're eating a lot of vegetable and a lot of protein, you should feel plenty satiated and be able to get to that caloric balance you're looking for. Now, fat actually has a reasonable satiating effect. Carbohydrate, not much, right? But if you had a good high-fat, high-protein meal, you'll feel very full for a long time. If you eat a big carbohydrate bolus, you won't. Easy example, you got about the same amount of calories in a slice of bread as you do an egg, but I promise you, if you cut out your slice of toast for breakfast in the morning, you wouldn't feel that different satiated-wise, but you would notice a difference in how hungry you feel a couple of hours later if you cut out an egg, right? So the satiating effect of protein and fat is very, very high. I wanted to add a little bit more color to this vegetable thing and give you some other reasons. So people know you should eat vegetables because of the vitamins and minerals and all that other stuff, but people often don't realize the phytochemicals. So these are really, really important as well, and they're generally only received in the form of vegetable. You can get them from some other places, but this is really the main source. So what phytochemicals do is, unlike a mineral or a nutrient, where you'll die without vitamin A, you'll die without magnesium or selenium, right? You have to have those. You don't have to have phytochemicals. But they do dramatically increase quality of life, specifically things like your immune system, getting sick or not getting sick a lot. Phytochemicals are very, very helpful for that. And so I wanted to show you what a comparison would look like here. So what I did is we're going to go through some of the energy information with a box of mac and cheese versus broccoli. Now, I make my class do this, and I would love for you to think about this in your own. How many of you think you could or maybe have eaten an entire box of mac and cheese in a single setting? I know I have, right? Now, some of you have maybe eaten a whole thing of broccoli like that, maybe, but not many people have done that, right? Well, if you look at the caloric balance here, obviously there's far fewer calories in that broccoli. So this allows you to do one of two things, whatever you'd like. Either you get to eat the broccoli and have a sixth of the calorie, helps you lose weight, or you get to eat six times as much food if you eat different food. Right? So you could eat six things of broccoli, actually, and be at the same amount of calories and be way full. Now, some of you that raised your hand that said you ate a whole thing of mac and cheese before, I bet you haven't eaten six things of broccoli, right? Especially raw like that. And if we start cruising down the profiles here, some of the things that start to jump out to us are, look at that potassium. Folks, that's 11.5 grams of potassium in that much broccoli. You could hold that as a big, huge horse pill in your hand, right? Carbohydrates, but look at all that fiber. Well, what do we have to do then? since we weren't counting for that earlier, and there's virtually no fiber in the mac and cheese, but there's a lot of fiber in our 1200, if you actually wanted to equate this for calories, you would have to go back and add a seventh thing of broccoli. All right, but we're not going to do that. We're just going to keep cruising on. Now, protein, of course, is a lot higher in the broccoli. We all know that the bioavailability of protein and broccoli is not high, so you wouldn't probably get all those 100, but it's going to be a lot more is the point. Vitamin A, 10 times the amount. Vitamin C, 5.5 grams versus none. Right? That's huge amounts of vitamin C. Calcium, 6 times as much. Iron, 5 times as much. Now, I know you're not going to eat 7 things of broccoli or 6 things of raw broccoli, but maybe you have the culinary skills to take broccoli and cut it up. Doesn't have to be pretty, even, none of that. Just cut it up. Can you do that? Can you turn a pan on medium heat? Don't go high. You'll ruin it. Medium to low. Great. Splash a little olive oil in there. Get a slab of meat. Cut it up. Doesn't have to be great. Don't even know what you have to do. You take those things, throw those in there, heat them all up, and you can get something like that. Right? So this would be a very satiating, very filling, fairly tasty meal, and it would be a third of the calories. Or you could eat 3 times the amount, however you want to look at it. Hell, if you wanted to eat that amount and then sprinkle a little bit of sour cream on it or some cheese or something like that, you would be very satiated, feel very good. It would be very tasty. Add some hot sauce if you're me. And you'd still be at half the calories. Right? So getting to a deficit is very reasonable without, you know, having to eat spinach all day. Oh boy, talk about spinach. You want to talk about calorically sparse foods. One of the major reasons why vegetables are so important for people trying to lose weight is they have virtually no calories in them. You could get a giant family-sized thing of lettuce or kale, and it's like 100 calories. It is virtually nothing. Carrots have virtually no calories in them. Don't worry about what the nonsense people tell you about that there's too much sugar in carrots. The glycemic load is tremendously low. There's very few calories in them. You could eat boatloads of calories, feel full, feel like you're eating all the time, and still be at a very low calorie intake. You can't do that with other foods. Right? So this is why vegetables are very, very helpful in managing a proper energy balance. All right, so to summarize here, do calories matter? Yes, of course they matter. But I will grant you, it's not the way most people think. Right? So focusing on quality, in other words, and here's the secret I'll tell you, just don't tell anybody. Don't let anybody admit this. I'm not even opposed to you telling people that calories don't matter. Because sometimes it has the net approach of getting them to focus on quality more, which means they end up eating better foods like animals, vegetables, fruits, whole foods, things like that. Just like the story I told you at the beginning of the talk. But information and accuracy is important, right? So we don't want people to have the incorrect idea here, because sometimes just that net effect is more effective, that net effect of focusing on quality is more effective than focusing on number. And so it provides the illusion that calories don't matter, when in fact they do, but your system of eating higher quality foods allowed it and made it much easier for you to be in a negative calorie balance, if that's the goal. So we sort of wrapped up all these things. Hopefully that was helpful. There's a lot more to the conversation, I know, but hopefully you learned some different things there. Now, what's interesting about this is a lot of people will sort of move the goalpost, if you will, with the argument. So a lot of people will talk about things like, hey, this food, and I'm not going to name any names here, so I'm pausing a little bit because I don't want to give them free shout-outs. But I've heard very prominent people on very prominent podcasts talk about things like, well, calories don't matter at all because, you know, you could add untold amounts of calories to something, but you would never do that, right? And what I'm getting at here is the last point. We do recognize that calories do influence behavior, satiety, but that's moving the goalpost, right? That's what we refer to that in logic. So just because something has a behavioral approach, that doesn't mean it's not true, right? So calories do matter. How it influences behavior is a way to manipulate the calories. So that's the same thing. What you're saying then is you're agreeing and you're acknowledging that calories do matter. You're just saying your approach makes people feel more full so they don't eat as much. So it's an easier way to get to a negative calorie balance. It's not proof that calories don't matter. In fact, it is proof they do matter. It's the exact opposite of what they're trying to argue. I almost don't want them to see that because I feel like when they're going to see this video, that part, they're going to be like, oh shit. Like, I didn't realize that fundamental thing that my evidence is actually arguing against me the whole time. Now, if you want to know more about physiology, I try to keep this about energy balance. It was about fat loss, of course, because that's a big part of the conversation. But if you want to know the specifics of fat loss, you can go to my website or check out the other video. I have a 55-minute fat loss video as well as a 5-minute one. So those of you with shorter attention spans or just want to catch the gist of it. And if you learn something in this video, you'll probably learn a lot in that physiology of fat video. So you can check that out on my YouTube channel, Andy Galpin, or on andygalpin.com. That's up and available for you. But I did want to end on a couple of practical tips and talk about some things of what to do. All right, so the first thing is caloric balance. Now, unlike most people, one of the big mistakes that gets made is you change calorie too much. What the research shows right now, whether you're trying to gain muscle or lose fat, is you don't want to manipulate calorie balance by more than 10 to 15%. So if you're trying to add muscle and you go up by more than 15%, and anyone that's done this knows exactly what I'm talking about, it's actually not sustainable. You feel terrible. You get sick. You don't feel like eating, and it's really, really hard to do that. In addition, if you add more than 10 or so percent in calories, you might continue to gain weight, but a higher percentage of that weight will start coming from fat. So if you're interested in gaining the absolute highest amount of weight possible, well then eat as many calories as you can get away with. But if you want to gain as much muscle as you can and not gain a lot of fat, don't go more than 10 or 15%. Now for fat loss, it's the other side of the equation here. Same thing. The evidence is pretty clear that the people who have the most success with losing weight and keeping it off for the longest are those that only reduce calorie intake by 10 or so percent. Don't need much more than that. If you crash too much, you end up being in that evolutionary biology issue of maybe shutting down meat too much. So be careful there. So the way I like to do that is by having a tremendous amount of veggies. I've talked about why that stuff's important earlier. Have some fat, have some protein. Like I said, try to go up in protein. It's very filling and has a high thermal effect. Focus on real food that helps actually accomplish all the things I said before. And regulate liquid calories. A lot of times people that have struggled with weight loss is because they're struggling with having a lot of extra calories in their food that they didn't realize were there because they're drinking calories, which are not satiating and don't have fiber. Make sure your approach, like I said, is satiating and sustainable. This is about a long-term behavioral win. Of course, you're hopefully aware that diets are not good. Lifestyle changes are a lot more effective. So this is something you want to do for the long term in the approach. The 90-90 rule is be consistent. So you can't do everything that I recommend doing for especially fat loss. So I would say shoot for 80, 90%. If you can do 90% of what I recommend 90% of the time, you'll be in a really, really good spot. And then the last one, of course, is patience, right? You gotta give yourself some time. It's a slow process. That is far more physiologically sustainable than crashing. And I could show you some evidence here. This is my own body weight getting ready for national championships 1 year. And I had to go from, as you can see, about 178 pounds all the way down to 151, which I did and performed great. But what's interesting about this graph, let's take a look at things like that. I mean, that's a chunk of about 6 weeks where, as I zoom in, I didn't do anything weight loss wise. I pretty much stayed on my diet. I was doing great. I was hungry a little bit, you know, not that perfect amount, but not much. I was at a caloric deficit, but I wasn't really losing weight. And so this can kind of fool you. If I zoomed in on this 6 weeks, I would think my diet isn't working at all. But if I zoomed out on the whole thing, it actually looks like I lost weight the entire time. So this is all a function of how zoomed in or zoomed out on that calendar you are. So if you're getting really frustrated with a diet that's not working, I want you to ask yourself, where do you think you're at right now? you might be zoomed in on one of those short month-long spans or something where you might plateau a little bit. But I want you to have that perspective of zooming out and go, well, what do you think? If I keep on this routine, if I keep doing well, do I really think I won't lose weight for the next year? Of course you will, right? So just be patient. You'll get there. And this also allows you to have days like this, right? Or like that. There's going to be some birthday trips to Vegas. There's going to be some holidays and other things like that. Live life. You're going to want to do that, right? Don't ruin your life to lose a little bit of weight. You're going to have to make some sacrifice, but we still want to make room for life in there. Right? So a couple of last thoughts. Ignoramus. This is something I live by as a scientist. I've committed to it. I have to willingly admit we're already way past our 55-minute time here, right? Which means I had to omit a lot of things. So no, I did not cover everything you ever need to know about energy balance. There is a lot of other stuff involved. Of course, hormones play a role, but there is no magic, as some of my colleagues call it, insulin fairy, right? That's been extremely well documented. But does that mean it doesn't matter at all? No, of course it matters, and it plays a very important role. Happiness, dopamine, serotonin, all these things play a role. And there's all kinds of other factors that go on the equation that we didn't get to, right? And that was just a function of time. So I am aware of a lot of them. I'm sure there's plenty of things I don't know. So this was very fun. We also have to consider context, right? There's a lot of other things that go into people making dietary decisions, even about calories, skin care, gut health, religious purposes, cultural practices. All that are important pieces of the puzzle that influence, say, energy balance that I didn't have time to get to. Mood, recovery, all that stuff, right? Trying to maximize performance. And so there's other things that context come into play, and that will always be true. So what's absolutely true in one context could be completely false in another context, and vice versa. So we do want to recognize this is not the end-all be-all, but hopefully you did learn something. I would encourage you to check this out. This is from the International Society of Sports Nutrition. Alan Aragon and Joey Antonio, Joey's organization, Alan Aragon led the paper. But this is fantastic. It is their position stand on diets and body composition. So if you want to learn about all the different diets, what's the evidence say for all these diets and how effective they are for fat loss, this is the best place to go. It has all of that research summarized for you. It's actually pretty easy to read, even for non-scientists. And again, good on the ISSN for making this open access, which means it's free. Anyone can look at it. It's not behind a paywall. You don't have to have a school email address or log in. Just Google the title. It's up on their website. You'll find it immediately. So a very, very good resource if you want to read more about what some specific diets, how effective some of them are, or not. That's all in there. So that being said, thanks a lot for joining me again. I appreciate the support as always. I would really, really appreciate it if you shared this stuff around on your YouTube, again, or your social media. Tag me. Help me spread the word. Obviously, this takes me a tremendous amount of time to put these things together, and it's a culmination of years of research, and so that's a lot of money and a lot of time that goes into these things. So I don't ask for much for you, just a little bit of help sharing things around if you enjoyed this. If you can afford it, I would also appreciate going to my Patreon account, so www.patreon.com/AndyGalpin, and kicking in a buck or two or buying me a virtual cup of coffee that way. You'll notice I don't take a penny of that for my own profit, but what I want to do, in fact, I have just recently hired somebody with the money that people have donated to put together study questions for these videos, also some blog notes, and a short write-up. So maybe you'll actually find out that you like just reading the write-up rather than watching videos as much. But that's how I actually do those things. So I can't afford to do any of those things on my own, and because it's a lot and it's a lot of work, and I have to have people help me with these things. So that's directly where that money goes. So I really appreciate any contribution you can make to that. And we'll help moving this forward. If you can afford it, cool. Just keep loving it, keep learning it, keep getting better, and keep making the world a better place. Share it if you can. If you don't have social media or anywhere else to share it, just enjoy it and make your life better. That's good enough for me. So I'll keep being as productive as I can based on how much support I can get. But if not, I will catch you next time, and I really appreciate it.